We're obviously really worried whether it's going to be 10 people or 50,000. We just didn't have a clue, and it's been a great turnout. So before we start, I'd just like to thank everybody for giving up the time this morning. But just one thing's just threw me a little bit, and there's a Mr. Nixon walked in this morning, and he's come up with some photographs from 1960, and he's asked if they can be personally passed on to Simon Garner. And they're of the original Blackburn Rovers Supporters Club, 1960, with holding the FA Cup. So obviously this is one of the reasons why we're here today, and it's a nice little touching start to the day, and just threw me off slightly. So what are we? Well, we're what it says on the tin, really. We're a collection of committed Blackburn Rovers supporters who are worried for the long-term future of the club, and we've been talking about this for over a year now, so this has not come about just pure down to relegation. This is purely the way the club has been run, the structure of the club, and the way it's been dismantled in the early stages and the latter stages, even as at today, with one of the long-term staff being removed. We come together to come up with a format where we can put the club in the ownership of the community, and by doing that, what's happened with the recent owners of the club can never happen again. Nobody can sell the crown jewels of the club. We can all have a stake in the club that we all support, and gives us the opportunity to have a say that we've very rarely had throughout its history. We've gathered together a lot of high profile people, because just as supporters, it isn't enough. We need to gauge the media's attention, and we've done that by getting some of the high profile names together that we've done. We're a registered company now in the UK, so BRSIT Limited now, and we're currently putting the final touches together to the final proposal scheme that will be tweaked today, depending on what people say and what questions they've got. So the team, my name is Wayne Wild. I'm Blackburn born and bred. I went to Queen's Park High School and Queen's Park Junior School, moved away for a while. I work in Darwin. I'm a group director of WEC Group, who are a large employer in Darwin, family-based, family-owned business. And I'm a lifelong Blackburn Rovers supporter, along with my two sons, who have both been mascots of the club, one of which was the mascot while he was 18 months old against Burnley in our 3-2 win. That I've got lots of pictures throughout work and home of that event. Daniel Grabko is a finance expert and co-founder. It was really his idea originally. This is a gentleman who proposed it to me. Between us, we kicked it about a bit. And Neil Thornton, again, a lifelong Blackburn Rovers supporter, owns his own PR company, who's been very, very helpful in putting all this together and getting it out to the national media, etc. I'm very, very pleased to announce, obviously, that we've got, as non-executive director, the legend Mr. Simon Garner, Blackburn Rovers' all-time leading goal scorer, even above the mighty Alan Shearer. These are a list of the other people who's been helping us out. Obviously, Glenn now has come on board, another Rovers legend. You know, getting the Rovers, ex-Rovers players to come and help us out has been a massive battle. There is definitely a cocoon around these guys, and they don't tend to want to get involved, so it's been very difficult. So for these guys to raise their heads above the parapet to help us has been more than helpful for us. High-profile supporters who have publicly said that they're backing our cause. Obviously, the biggest one so far is Jack Straw. I know he's well known throughout Blackburn, but he has a massive pull worldwide. You know, don't forget he was Foreign Secretary and Home Secretary. The guy's extremely well known throughout the world. Jake Berry, Darwin MP, Graham Jones, Ironman MP, Brian Simpson, the MEP. So to have these guys throws a lot of weight behind what we're doing. Care to Learn, who's the leader of Blackburn and Darwin Council, who's very kindly donated this room today. So Bill Taylor, who's been a massive help in what we're doing, really trumping what we're trying to do. Phil Watson, the ex-chief executive of Blackburn's given his full support, along with Lord Taylor of Blackburn and Lord Patel. Colin Mustow is the chairman of Senator International, was one of the first men to break ranks and come out and lead his support. Senator employ 1,000 people, again, predominantly Rovers fans, and it's important that we get these guys involved. Vernon Yerkness, who's the MD of Cleverbox, is current sponsors of Accrington Stanley, and Wayne Hemingway from Ready Dead Labels has voiced his support as well. As well as that, more importantly than all that is really all the fans groups. And I know there's various factions, and some may not agree with what others do, but there isn't one so far who's publicly come out and said they haven't supported us, and everybody has said that there's a lot of these fans groups here today, and I'm sure that they'll have certain things to say. And various regional and international fans associations throughout the world, The second biggest pledged city is Oslo in Norway, so that shows you how far we can reach this out far and wide. So what is it? What are we trying to achieve? What we're trying to achieve is raise enough funds to go to the current owners to give them a dignified exit so that they don't lose face and they can sell the club to the community. The community, in total, will own Blackburn Rovers. That is the ultimate goal. So there's an initial target of £10 million. That £10 million is a notional amount of money to get us a seat at the table, to sit down and say, this is the money we've got, we want to talk. Where that leads us, we don't know, and we'll come on to that much more later. But it's £1,000 a share, 10,000 shares. Again, there'll be questions about why it's £1,000 and it's too much, but again, we'll try and talk around that later on. One member, one vote. This is a community society bid, whereas the whole of the football club will be owned by the supporters. If we don't have a successful bid, then there's no commitment. All funds, once we start collecting them in, will be fully returned to all the members. So no bid, if it doesn't happen, there is no financial loss, there'll be no cost come out of this in any way. The plan will be to have an annual general meeting where every shareholder will have a voice and able to say, bring their thoughts and aspirations to the table. And we'll appoint a board of directors. That board of directors will hopefully come from the world of sport, who will have experience in running football clubs day to day, what they do. This isn't for us to run. This is a board of directors of the club that will run it with the experience and magnitude and who we can get to be able to do it. What we won't have is a specific involvement into the day-to-day footballing decisions. That will be made by the people that the board of directors will employ, the coaching staff and the management staff, etc. So the structure that we're at, and this has changed a number of times and may possibly change again depending what position we get into, but it's a community benefit society, the benefit of the society, as it says. It's £1,000 a share. These shares are withdrawable, but they are non-transferable. Shares can be withdrawn at any point with the board of directors agreement. Shares cannot be bought or sold on the open market. So what we're trying to do is lock the funds in, so it's not easy to take out. You can take them out, but only at the agreement of the board of directors. It's an asset lock. So they can never increase in value. So this isn't about making money for individual. This is not an investment strategy. This is about locking money into the community to enable the community to buy the football club. The maximum possible investment risk if you put in is £1,000, and the possible return of that is £2,000, which I'll go into a little bit more. But we've come up with a plan of a Rovers rewards card. And as I've said before, if we don't have a successful bid, then there's no commitment. All funds will be returned. What we've proposed to give is to encourage people to buy shares is to give them a return, and that return will be a fixed 5% per annum. So of £1,000 share, you will get £50 fixed return. That return will go in the form of Rovers rewards, so that money will go onto a, for want of a better word, a type of card, membership card. So if you put £5,000 in, you'll get £250 a year. That in today's current prices of season tickets would equate to a free season ticket. Over 20 years, you're actually getting your full money back, plus you've still got your £1,000 share in the club. How do you fund this, is the first question. Well, you fund it by good business running. Currently, we don't have a shirt sponsor. That shirt sponsorship was worth £1.5 million a year that the Venkies didn't take up for a number of reasons. So this, over a £10 million share bid raise, would cost £500,000. So it's only one third of a shirt sponsorship. So we've put the numbers together and we've worked hard to come up with this proposal and we know it can work. One of the questions that's been fielded is the fact that people are saying they can't afford the £1,000 share, but they'd like to buy a share. Now, we've gone round and round in circles with this, but in order to fund £10 million as a minimum, we've got to sell a number of shares. And if we make them shares £100 a piece, we're going to have to sell 10,000. In the community we've got, it's an almost impossible task. So we've had to do all the sums and put it together to come up with a number. In order to help people who said that they can't afford it initially, we've contacted the Jubilee Credit Union, who are here today, they have a stand at the back. Please go and talk to them. I had never heard of this before, even though I worked around the corner from it, and I think it's an absolutely fantastic scheme. It's a way that you can pay into a savings scheme, that they'll loan you money at very, very low interest rate, and it's funding and loaning that is done with by vetting the people rather than just going on your payday loans, etc. Of £1,000, if you put £250 into there, they'll loan you £750, and I think over 18 months it's about £40 to £50 worth of interest. So loan numbers in comparison of borrowing over 18 months. So these are some of the regular queries that we've already had. How much do you think will be needed to buy the club? I ain't got a clue. We don't know. We know how much money they've paid for it. We know how much money they've invested into the club. But what is it worth today? It's only worth what somebody's willing to pay for it. Now, we're not a Premiership club anymore. A lot of the assets have been sold off since they bought it. So we don't know what the current financial state of play is with the club, because unless we got a current up-to-date set of management accounts, it would be very, very difficult. Who will run the club? As we've already said, it would be owned by the community. The community trust will appoint a board of directors, and that board of directors would run the football club. They would appoint a management structure in terms of the day-to-day running, so that's the manager and coaching staff, etc., etc. Does Premiership status matter? Not for this, it doesn't. Doesn't matter which league we're in. This can work in whatever league that there is. Does it matter for the town and the people? Of course it does. So the aim is to get us back up there, of course. Are we going to lay in the club with debt? Well, the straight answer is no. You know, this is how clubs get into severe financial difficulty, and we've seen one of the world's biggest clubs about to fold, possibly because of the way they've got into. But all businesses and all clubs at times have got to borrow money. Now, if that's decided by the board of directors that it's a good idea and it's low risk, then that'll be up to the shareholders and the directors at the time. Rovers away membership, how will it affect the club's income? Again, I think I've touched on that already, really, that we think that by doing some good active marketing, running the club correctly, engaging with local businesses, selling corporate sponsorships that they just don't do whatsoever at the moment, we can easily cover the cost of giving money back to the members. We've just under £2 million at the moment. We're hoping just to break that line to be able to give the number, but we're just slightly under it. Now, I know in terms of football and Premier League, it's a minute amount of money. But in terms of the value of a club, for what Venky's paid, they paid £23 million. We're at 10% of that already, not so far off. And that's with 95% of people sat on the fence. So this is part of today, is to get this message across, explain how all this works, and can we really achieve what we can? You know, the amount of people that turned up today just shows that people are interested in what we're doing. Will we be willing to become a part owner in cooperation with other bids? Of course. If somebody comes who wants to buy the club in its entirety or a portion of the club, who've got the right interests at heart for the right reasons, then of course we will. We'll talk to anybody and everybody. I know there's rumours of various other bids going out at the moment, and if they come to fruition, fantastic. But why would any bidder not want this community involved? It doesn't make sense. We've united the whole thing. We've got an umbrella structure where we've got the supporter groups, we've got supporters, we've got businesses, we've got MPs, council leaders, community leaders. If you have that under your umbrella, why would somebody not want to come to us and say, we want your help in pulling all this together? So if people want us to be involved, of course we'll be involved in it. What the structure would that take would depend on the people and the bid at the time. So of course we do. Right, that's my, thank you very much for being quiet. So we're at Q&A stage.
In regards to Eagle Park, the training centre and the other training centre, like the assets, who owns them? Is it the Venkies, is it Jack Walker, whatever?
The assets are fully owned within the ownership of the club. So for what we would buy off the current owners, you would get all the assets with it. That includes all the structural, all the assets, including Eagle Park and the training ground, etc.
Right, so the rumours are correct then. They're looking to sell the original training facility.
I don't think they can, because I think there's a covenant on them, is there?
Hello?
Yep.
Hello.
Okay, good. Yeah, that is my understanding, that there is some form of covenant. We don't know the details of it, but we're hoping that is the case, that they just can't sell off either the Ewood Park or Brock Hall or any of the training facilities.
Hi, Wayne George Lamb. We've never met, but I think you're doing an absolutely fantastic job, and for the valuation for the effort that you put into it, and I'd like to thank you very much indeed. A couple of things. What is the maximum one can put in?
The original idea was to have a maximum of 1%, so of £10 million, obviously, the maximum being £100,000. The current scheme that we've pulled together to be a community benefit society is £20,000, is that right? But that £20,000 can be split. So if you wanted to split that between yourself, your wife, your children, etc., etc. So if you wanted to build that up, then by all means. But obviously, one of the critical issues is as a community benefit society, we don't want, ideally, somebody to own 50% of that, of course. The point is that we all have a share in it, and the current system is that it's one member, one vote.
Yes, I think that's very good. And my second question is, would it support our interest either to go to the matches or not go to the matches?
That isn't really for me to say at this point. We'd all get into a long, long discussion. You know, today is about our proposal. It's not about my personal views on either the manager or the structure. This is about the ownership of Blackburn Rovers, so we can change these fundamental issues.
But of course, if it hasn't got very much support, it isn't worth as much, is it?
No, but I still don't think it's fair to have a negative impact on the club just to impact on what we can achieve. We should be able to achieve what we can off our own standing, really. It's up to us to put the message out and inform people. We don't want people to join us just because people are not going to the games. You know, that would have a negative impact. We don't want a negative impact. This is for the football club and the community in the town. So I think it would be incorrect of us to advise people not to go.
Thank you.
Can I just, can we let Simon just have 5 minutes? And Simon, if you can just explain to the audience of, you know, everybody, every single person in this room knows who you are.
You sure?
My son didn't, but anyway.
I was going to say, I don't know about Mr. Nixon, because he thinks I was in the 1960 Cup team.
But you know as well as anybody, I've had serious trouble trying to get the ex-players, and a lot of them live locally. I've asked them to come out and help us out, and not do anything, but literally just put the name to it. You know, Glenn has kindly just come to the table, but lots of the guys haven't, and you have. I just want you to explain to the audience why you would get involved and why you would do this.
Well, I was getting worried about the future of the football club. I mean, relegation was bad enough, but then you start... I live 200 miles away now, so I don't hear all the local stories. But what I do hear, the dribs and drabs, that the supporters are worried about which way the club's going. They can see it falling all the way through the league and things like that, and finishing up like Bradford. And that's the last thing I want. I mean, I spent the majority of my career at Blackburn Rovers. The fans was always good to me. I tried to be good to the fans, and I tried to be honest with them and whatever. And my honest opinion now is, I don't think the Venkies are the right owners of the football club. So as soon as Wayne asked me to get involved, I jumped on the bandwagon straight away and I said, yes, I will help you out any way I can. Hopefully it will help because of my name. I'm not trying to brag or anything there, but hopefully it will help a bit that people will get involved and see how serious we are about trying to get the club back into ownership where people know what's going on there. I mean... I saw the interview on Sky Sports News with the Venkies, and what do you say about the fans? They're like the family or something. Well, you speak to your family, and they don't communicate. I mean, I'm not slagging them off, don't get me wrong. I could turn around and slag them up and whatever, but they just need to realise how the fans of Blackburn feel, and it's just a shame that the club has... Well, relegation happened, but it's a shame as what's happening to the football club. Even if they'd stayed in the Premiership... it wasn't going forward. I mean, you can say what you want about the manager, I'm not going to get involved with that neither, but there just didn't seem to be any desire to go forwards from the owners, and that's what worried me as well. I mean, I don't think they fully understand football, and that's what they need to do, so we need to get our voice out there and make them understand how passionate we are about this football club. I know Wayne said it's tough to get ex-players on board. That was another reason why I came on, and Glenn's come along today. There's other players, ex-players, who are starting to dribble in and say they're going to support the club, support our cause and everything like that, and that's what we need. I mean, yes, I've got a lot of feeling for this football club, but it's still not going to stop me from speaking out about what's going on in it. I mean, I'm not going to sit on the fence and stay in the background. I want this club to be successful, and that's what I want to see.
Thanks, Sam. And Glenn, if you could just give your involvement, please.
Well, I suppose I've been worried about the club ever since the Yankees took over and saw the first things they did, when none of which sort of made any sense to me. I suppose I'm not really politically correct as such. I've got a lot of friends still involved in the game who are ex-players, and I know why they won't come forward at the moment, like anyone wouldn't, where the jobs are concerned. However, we have owners who, I don't know, are they business people? Because it doesn't seem to make any sense what they do, and I think they've been poorly advised, so not necessarily our fault. I think they have no understanding at all of football and the way it's run in this country, and I think they should do a lot more to do that. But the first thing I see is that we have a manager who's poor at best.
Who invited him? Look, we'd all love to stand here, and nobody more than me would love to stand here and spend the next half an hour venting my spleen about the frustrations of what's happened since the new owners took on board. But my position is to try and remain professional and come out with a plan that we can do something about it. And the only thing that's going to help is to pull together and become a part of this. So.
We're all fans here, and we all want the best for the club, and say we do buy it, I want to know what happens next. Where's the money going to come from for transfers, players' wages, just general running of the club?
Good question, fundamental question, isn't it? But if you look past the last 10 years, there's not really been any investment in the club. The Walkers stopped putting the £3 million a year in 2007, and since then the club has run like a club should be run, and that's on its earnings, and having a good chief executive and chairman in place who runs a good business. John Williams and his team run a very tight ship for a long time. But if you look at their accounts, they lost £1 million, won £1 million, lost £1 million, won £1 million. They run as a break-even business. And that's the way that we'd have to run it. You know, if you've thoughts of us competing against Chelsea, who have just invested, Man City, who have just invested £930 million in 3 years, then it ain't going to happen, is it? Now, if somebody comes on board with us who has got the sort of investment who wants to plough into the club, fabulous. We'll open our arms out wide and invite them in. But as it stands, there is nobody on a white horse anywhere riding into town. So unless that happens, then great. But as it stands, we would run the club as a break-even target club where we would reinvest any income into the playing squad and try to compete at the top table.
My question's about appealing to expat Rovers fans, and I don't think the website really, or the way that you're doing the 5% bond, or whatever you call it, for which is held.
Rovers Reward.
Products is kind of going to appeal to them. I mean, I've pledged a few grand, but I'm going to go and live in Spain from January. Now, I'm quite happy to put another couple in to top it up to 5, but I'd like then to be able to give those rewards to my daughter who's going to be living here so she can have a season ticket. But at the moment, on the website, it doesn't say you can do that unless you give your shares to somebody.
Okay. Well, again, this is the reason for this meeting, is people to raise that sort of issue. And we can easily get over that.
Yeah,
we can answer that quite.
I think it's a point that the town I'm going to, I know at least two other ex-Rovers season ticket holders that live there. They're not going to use those, but I know both of them have friends and family back here in Blackburn. And for them, £4,000 or £5,000, the availability to cover a season ticket is good. But it's only good if they can give it to
Yeah, if you think about the possibilities are endless. And what we could have is a pot of money that's created by expats.
If I could just step in quick. I think the plan is to have your Blackburn Rovers Supporters Investments Trust membership card. You have to swipe that card or input the card in order to redeem your Rovers rewards. What you could do is leave the card with your daughter, for example. You can also use the card to keep up to date. You know, Rovers' website right now has premium services for overseas supporters that show video highlights, that do Radio Rovers over the web, etc. And that costs money. You can use that.
One of the things we talked about, we're having a pot, so the people who didn't want to take the rewards, we put it into a pot, and possibly we have the Rovers Community Charity, where, you know, we give people who, you know, children from school or whatever, free season tickets, and the costs come out of that pot. There's lots of ideas that could come from that.
I want to ask, the 16 million, 16 million, 8 million, 8 million, which is due to come into the club as part of the parachute payments, I think they call it, or whatever they call it. How safe is that in terms of being protected?
The answer to that question is that it's not. The way the parachute payments would work is that it just gets paid in just like the Sky money does for the Premier League. But then normally what a football club would do would use that to cover the wages that they still have for a lot of their players at premiership levels, so they can slowly change their wage structure to cope with being in the championship. Of course, there's a danger that instead our club will just sell all of those players and pocket as much of that money as they can. But we can't. There's nothing that can be done to stop them from doing that.
Wait, what's the practicalities of the pledge? How does it start? Where does the money go? Is it legally binding? What is it about?
Right, the current format is purely pledge at this moment. Supporters Direct this week have advised us to turn them pledges into cash as soon as we possibly can.
How does a pledge start? Just explain. I mean, who do you speak to?
Well, there's two ways to do it. The only way before today was to go onto the website. There's a pledge form, very simple procedure. You literally put your details in, press enter, and it records that pledge with all your details in.
I thought if you're a dinosaur like us and we don't have a computer.
Thanks, Mum. They're doing a good job. That's why we're here today, because we appreciate there's lots of ways. There's social media, there's internet, etc. There's newspapers. Today we've a lot of pledge forms at the back. Perfect timing. Please just fill them in. Just fill them in. A lot of volunteers at the back will collect all the pledge forms, put them together.
Can you? Yeah, say two or three lads got together, put the money in. Would it be one name on the shirt, or would it could be multiple?
You'd probably have to come up with some kind of a name for yourselves.
Similar to a lottery sort of syndicate, I would think, similar to that. But again, we haven't got into details of that, but we will at the time that should not become available.
Like one bank account.
Mm.
Yeah. You probably noticed that Liverpool, under their previous ownership, they were able to force a sale. I just wonder if that's a possibility about with what you're doing.
Damn.
Not in the same way. It's a different situation. It would be very hard for us to. I don't really have a much better answer. It'd be very difficult for us to actually be able to put somebody in that situation from where we are. But until they decide that they've lost enough money, yeah, that's good. Thank you, Richard.
It wasn't the supporters that forced the sale of Liverpool. It was the banks, apparently. So it was the banks' leverage that did what they did. Now, if you look at the current situation, you know, it is quite secretive, but from what we can gather, all the debt has been paid to Barclays. Barclays are no longer the bankers of the club, which again would raise concerns, as it's now no longer a UK bank that's supporting Blackburn Rovers. So again, we have to be careful we don't go into areas that will get us into trouble, but the situation we're in.
Wait.
So,
are we refusing applications from the Burnley area?
Yes.
That's a good question.
Yes.
Yes.
If you have a Burnley postcode, move.
We're manually going through every pledge that comes in. So.
So I'll just finish off really. I really want to thank everybody who's been today, the crew behind this. There's some fantastic volunteers. There's a lot of guys at the back who are doing all this out of their own time. You know, businesses are putting their time and effort behind it.
But at the end of the day, we're only for one cause. Get our club back on track for the future. That's the main thing.
We're at a point where, you know, the guys, people like Jack Straw, texting me on Christmas Day and saying, you know, all the best, keep going. We're doing it for all the right reasons. And, you know, there's a lot of people who put a lot of time and effort into this. And again, you know, the panel I'm going to thank, Mr. Garner has helped us raise a profile dramatically. It pledges spiralled upwards from the day that Simon got involved and has been very supportive on all the national media. Big thanks to Glenn for dropping me in it in national team. Neil Thornton, lifelong Rovers supporter. I feel like I'm at Bath today, just yassing them out there. So I'll just, everybody involved, all the guys at the back, the camera crews, the film, King George's Hall, Blackburn and Darwin Council have supported us by giving us this fantastic room for free. We're going to do this again, and next time hopefully we'll get a bigger room than this and we'll get everybody in, and there'll be more people who will pledge then and bring the people who haven't. But so I'm just going to wrap it up and say thank you very, very much for everybody coming today. I know it's a beautiful summer's day, so thanks for coming. At the back, Simon's going to take some photographs with everybody, but I can wrap it up and say thank you very much all for coming. Thank you.